So thanks for the invitation. So here I'm going to discuss how to recreate the shell experience and follow basically what we have done actually in MadGraph. So while speaking about user interface, so from my point of view, that's one of the main crucial elements for any applications, even though a lot of people really don't care about it. I mean, the most important part, of course, of any applications is the physics, is what the problem your code is able to solve, obviously. At the same time, the user interface is really the first thing that users are going to encounter. So they came to your program, of course, because they want to solve a given problem. But after, there are many, typically many solutions for a given problem. And they are going to use your program or not, depending on how fast they can go from learning your program to the solution to their problem, obviously. So it's important to my point of view that all user interfaces are intuitive. So even if people, most of them don't consider that as important, I think it's really important. And people are sometimes confused about themselves because I hear the same people saying, I don't care about user interface, but then be extremely nitpicking about every details on them. So that's a bit confusing. For the developer, so as people developing, it's important that the user interface is quite flexible, obviously, so they can include new features. That's quite common in energy physics. You start by being able to fix a small problem, and then people come to you, oh, what about if you can fix this, and then this, and then this, and your program suddenly needs to go actually to basically fix all the problem physics. So my computer is frozen, looks like. Okay. Do you still hear me?
Yeah, I can hear you. The slide is still on page 2.
Yeah, me too, actually. It's frozen there.
No, nothing like it. And let's see if you can close it and reopen again. Or...
Yeah, it looks like I cannot do anything.
Wait a second. I can try and share it for you.
Let me try to stop sharing my screen. Yes. Then we try sharing the screen. Let's start that.
Oh, it's a big, very big file. Now I see. The PDF is 154 megabytes. Is that correct?
Maybe it's possible, I don't know. Yeah, do you see my screen now?
One second. Yeah.
So let's try that, and then if it's pause again, maybe you can try to share your screen.
Yeah.
What I want to describe here today is not the full details of the user interface, but basically what we are using in MadGraph. And what the building tools we have used to build that inside MadGraph. Because I hear a lot of people saying, oh, your user interface is fantastic. It has a lot of good feedback. So I want just to basically say here, okay, that is, we have done it. That's the main idea. Then so that other people can basically use and do whatever you want for your own code. So there are basically two types of command line interface. I'm interested in command line because that's basically what most of people are using, of course, in energy physics. And basically you have by parameter, you can pass, you have a function and a bunch of parameter, you know a lot of programs from that. Or you have interactive sessions. And there you have more, you're asking the user to interact with you to ask a lot of questions. And it can be really quite daunting, I would say, because if you have a lot of branching, that can be quite a nightmare easily. Sometimes, of course, it's what you want. The function space, for example, that's exactly what you want. You have a lot of fine control on exactly what's going on. So that's exactly what you want. But then it's very difficult, of course, to script that part, obviously. So what I like about user interactive session is that it's much more user friendly. You can really help the user to go to the solutions more quickly. The downside is if it's not coded carefully, it can be very difficult to script. And therefore, it's quite be quite bad in the long term to maintain that, especially if you have a lot of questions, a lot of tools. So what I think is a good mix between the two is really a Python shell interface. So it's really an interface like shell, where you have auto-completions, you have a set of comments with different set of arguments, and you have auto-completion. That's really helps the user to go through. And one thing I like quite a lot that we have implemented is a tutorial mode. So the first thing you write on the shell, then you say to the user, if you don't know to use this code, type tutorial. And then the user can type tutorial. And then you have precise instructions how to go and then basically make the code himself make easily to go through for any Lambda user that for after 15 minutes, well, in your case, at least not 30 and 15 minutes, you can go and learn all the commands that are needed basically to run the code. So this is actually very simple to do. You have a Python built-in package for doing that, which is CMD. The downside is extremely basic. I will show you in 2 seconds what it's doing. It's extremely basic, very simple to handle. That's good, obviously. But then it doesn't have any advanced feature. So if you want that, I will not cover that, but you have CMD2 package, but that one is not built in. You need to install it by pip, very easy, obviously. So here's an example of a CMD interface. So a shell interface with one command, the hello world. So not very long, very easy to do. You of course first have to import the CMD command, and then you instantiate a new class. And then you can go to functions. So the first one is mandatory, the second two others are not really needed. So the first one need to start by do underscore and then the name of your command. So that's really how the interface know, okay, that's a new command that the user can type. The user can type hello world, then anything you want. In this case, there's no parsing at this stage. And then you define the functions and what needs to be done in this case. So really that's just the keyword, do underscore, and then you can do whatever you want. Second functions is help, so that you can customize the help. The default is to use the doc string of the do underscore functions, but you can basically here even more extensive commands and basically build around that. And the third function is a bit difficult, I would say, to code. That's really what takes us a lot of time to do it correctly, I would say. But that's very useful is this auto completion feature. So that if the user type this, what should I do to extend the possibility? And therefore, the next thing to run is just basically running the code. It's depend on read line, and that makes sense because then you have history and all this auto completions mode, obviously. One small trick is that in Mac, they have something slightly different. So in my case, I need to bind the completions like this and not like that for normal read line, new read line, I would say. But otherwise, that's very standard. And that's basically it. And that you have now a full workable interface, in this case with one command, so not very useful. Let's give you a lot of freedom that therefore to add new command, add a new mode to your program and so on and so on. So let me go to the demonstration. So here on the right, I have the one of MathGraph when you see the help command with many, many commands that allow to go to a lot of directions. And here on the left, I will just run the command I have set. So it enter me to a common interface. I able to completions. And it tells me they have two commands that start by H actually to complete up to L. So I can do hello world. And then again, auto completions. And that's it. So that really gives you a lot of freedoms to basically do a nice user interface where you can have interactions with the user, but at the same time, if all the freedom and power, I mean, power of basically single commands next to each other, you can combine them, of course, and stuff like that. To finish this basic feature of CMD, but there is actually not much more to that. So that's very simple, but not that much powerful. So if you, in MathGraph, we've done it to basically add a couple of features to simplify your life at the end of the day, like better completions, we have a way to say, or what the user printed so that we have nice bug report and so on. A lot of that is already available in CMD, CMD2, sorry. Typically, we don't try to have that much dependency in MathGraph, so that's why we didn't rely on CMD2, like argparse automatic. So you define your functions with argparse and automatically help and auto completions. That's a wonderful attribute in MathGraph as well. Thank you.
Thanks very much. Okay, you're already sharing. Thanks very much. Yeah. She does know, so maybe I can ask a question. You just mentioned MathGraph, but how is this really making a difference and impact for your daily work, actually?
Well, that's really, it's also because in MathGraph we have, I would say, our main code, but we have also side project in a way. that rely really on the basic of Malgraph, which is a matrix event generator. So that's the part which is basically common to everything. But then after that, you can say, well, I want only to evaluate one matrix point, or I want to have that code, but in Fortran, or that code in C++, or I want to do a phase space integration. So I want to do a reverse engineering from going from the data to the theory. So in that way, we have really a lot of options that start in the same way, but then diverge completely. And that's really the way in Malgraph it's done. It's typically always the same first comment. Then depending of what you want to do, then you decide a new comment actually.